was a metaphysical ransom payment facilitating the way to redemption, salvation of Earth humanity, third density souls. Meaning it has metaphysical power to be free of demiurge and archonic control, or 3D repeating. 3D, you know, souls repeating in the density. And it is very true that lower astral entities hate Yeshua, and certain evil humans hate Yeshua. Hate, with a big H. And the ones that hate God or hate Yeshua are generally under the control of Archons, Demiurge, Orion, negative entities on the astral plane. Demonic possession, demonic control, all those entities really hate Yeshua and Christianity. And that's part of what's going on today with the Illuminist purge of global Christianity and murder of Christians globally and degradation of Western European civilization and America. Is a destruction of the pathway made possible by Yeshua, by his willing offering as a ransoming for humanity, facilitating redemption, salvation, but really the freedom of humanity to get out of 3D cycling. Very real metaphysics involved here. Going back to a lower level, Jungian symbolic analysis. These two sacraments, apolytrosis, redemption, the Gnostics knew about Yeshua this way too, you know, and bridal chamber are more esoteric Gnostic sacraments. Holder goes on, the bridal chamber, or pneumatic union, spirit union, is by far the most frequently alluded to of the greater sacraments. The Gospel of Philip makes constant references to it, and statements concerning it are scattered in a large number of the Gnostic scriptures, bridal chamber and pneumatic union. Irenaeus, church father, associates this sacrament of bridal chamber, whatever that is, primarily with the followers of Valentinus, but the theoretical foundations serving as its psychological rationale are present in the corpus or body of Gnostic writings generally, meaning not only Valentinus, but other Gnostics discussed this male-female union, bridal chamber, ritual, practice, spiritual ceremony, what is it? It's hard to say, but we go on with it. Thus, the Gospel according to Thomas, the Gospel of Thomas, which is generally considered to be relatively free of Valentinian influences, we started this series to get to the Gospel of Thomas, and we'll get there someday. Gospel according to Thomas, generally considered to be relatively free of Valentinian influences, though Marcionite, from Marcion, presents us with what might be considered the clearest formulation of the theoretical foundation of the bridal chamber in its 22nd Logion. So we see that Marcion's Gospel of Thomas, if there is some connection there, also Nag Hammadi text, the Gospel of Truth, also Nag Hammadi Valentinian, which we'll get to, have many of the same esoteric principles or teachings. So, from the Gospel according to Thomas, very Gnostic, very alchemical and mystic, says, quote, when you make the two one, and when you make the inner as the outer, and the outer as the inner, and the above as the below, and when you make the male and the female into a single one, so that the male will not be male, and the female not be female, then shall you enter the kingdom. Boom. This is the alchemical, esoteric means by which we achieve knowing gnosis of the law of one. Unity. The union of the upward and the lower. realization of Sotapanna, or contact with intelligent infinity? Maybe, sure. The two become one. The two is seen as one. The outer and inner is known as one field. The male and the female are known as two poles of a polarity that is a single field. Polarity, the oppositorum of two poles, is a unified field. polarity is simply the apparent oppositorum, or opposites, of a unified field. Light and dark, night and day, male and female, inner and outer, above and below. And so when the two has become one, we enter the kingdom of heaven. The kingdom of heaven is within. It's not outside. But the outside is known according to the transformation of consciousness of the inner, or the mind. Transformation of mind leads to transformation of world, or perception of the transformation of the perception of world. If you wish to change your life, change your mind. When thine eye becomes single, thy body shall be full of light. Yeah. The third eye is a single, is a singularity. Yeah. The eye above the pyramid is not illuminist. Sorry, that eye is the eye of the Logos. And the illumination is love light of the One Infinite. And the negative entities simply co-opt all the terminology and symbolism, as usual. So, sounds pretty alchemical. Sounds pretty esoteric. Esoteric what? Tantric? Making the two one? And you can see how sexual practice evolved from that. The two becomes one. The male is not male, and the female is not female. And in fact, the outer is no longer called outer, and the inner is no longer considered inner. Presence and sentience are united. The sense of separative presence and the sense of separative sentience, meaning this is my mind, this is my consciousness, this is me here, my little self, localization and separate, you know, view of a differentiation between here and there, and me and you, and mind and outer field, all that falls away. Holder goes on. We won't finish this page. The psychological basis upon which the bridal chamber ritual, or achievement, is founded is fairly easily understood. The gnosis considers the human being as divided and fragmented within itself. The divisions have numerous aspects. We are involved in what modern psychology would call an ego-self dichotomy. That's very Jungian. In an anima-animus dichotomy, all Jungian. In a body-mind dichotomy, in a subjective-objective dichotomy, and many others. All these divisions require mending or healing. Even as the pleroma, or divine plenum, meaning the universal field, is characterized by wholeness, so the human being must once again become whole and thereby acquire the qualifications to re-enter the pleroma, meaning the divine unified field. Contemporary, especially Jungian depth psychology, envisions such a pneumatic union as the ultimate objective of what it calls the individuation process. Unlike Jungian psychologists, who can offer only the practice of analysis as an instrumentality of the process of reunification, Valentinus was apparently inspired to document and ritually dramatize this union in the great sacrament of the bridal chamber. The Sophia myth, and there's another doctrine, a Gnostic doctrine, Gnostic document called the Treatise of Sophia, or the Pistis Sophia, their Gnostic writing titled with Sophia in them. The Sophia wisdom, Sophia myth, serves in many ways as the mythological support of this sacrament. The myth implies that the creation of the imperfect world and the confinement of the soul within it originated through the disruption of the original spiritual unity of the Pleroma, so that the return of the soul into the loving embrace of her bridegroom, as indicated by the return of Sophia into the arms of Jesus, Yeshua, then represents the healing of this disruption and restoration of wholeness. Nice, deep stuff. So the Jungian archetypal psychologists do go quite deep. And they basically discuss spiritual transformation in spiritual psychological terms, which is which is very helpful. It's not the end of the line, but it's very helpful. So we're talking about the bridal chamber. This may be where we end You see how this goes on and on and on. So to unpack this, we won't be able to complete it today, but let me just finish this paragraph, and next week we're going to continue discussion of the bridal chamber theory and practice. You can call it a ritual, you can call it a metaphor for the completed, the alchemical vessel by which completion occurs, or unification, reunification, or realization of unity. You know, what appears or is experienced as two is really one. The experience of duality is apparently real, it's experientially real, and it's essentially empty or illusory. It's experienced, and appears real for sure. And essentially, the duality is a unity. Two poles of all polarity represent basically a particular mathematical arrangement by which differentiation appears and is maintained to perception. Sorry. The gnosis considers the human being as divided or fragmented within itself. Same thing with Buddhism, but Buddhism or Hinduism, you know, considers it basically the effect of maya or illusion of the world, and ignorance, avidya, the distortion that establishes ultimately the last fetters, restlessness and ahamkara or self-conceit. Look at the Buddhist 10 fetters. Avidya is 10, restlessness 9, self-conceit is 8. Which was, you know, Ramana Maharshi's great teaching target was, deconstructing ahamkara, deconstructing the fashioned, conceptual, naming activity-based samskara sense of self. The Sotapanna, first level awakening in Buddhism, destroys the false opinion, the false view, that any view of self could be accurate. And self is realized as empty, although not fully disassembled or deconstructed until fourth stage arhat. But the human being as divided and fragmented within itself is a, you know, introductory way or a, you know, non-magnified way of saying that the human consciousness is subjectivist and dualistic and experiences countless polarities and dualities based on ultimately, you know, I think the Buddhist 10th, 9th, and 8th fetters of essential avidya or being in the octave or awareness identifying with vehicle, you see. You know, the five skandhas are all vehicular. Hey. Meaning, body, feelings, sensations, perceptions of body and perceptions of mind, and the fashionings of mind and consciousness itself, all the five skandha set, upadana skandha, the clinging aggregates, Buddhism, they are vehicles of infinite awareness, or the logos. The octave is the vehicle of the logos, body, mind, spirit, beingness, totality complex, seven-dimensional, seven energy fields, sense of self, or evolving entity, or evolving point of light, is all vehicle for intelligent infinity. But awareness, naked, infinite, boundless awareness, identifies with its vehicle, and therefore experiences countless polarities. But the process by which infinite awareness, boundless awareness, identifies with its vehicles is a step down from the 10th, 9th, 8th fetters of avidya, ignorance, basic ignorance, and restlessness, and ahamkara, or the fashioning of a separative selfhood, the sense of self, subjective consciousness, dualistic consciousness, subjectivism, subjectivity, me, I'm here, you're there, I'm in here, you're out there, that's over there, the field. This is in here, the mind, the me. That is the essential dualism that is itself illusory. It's empty. There's nothing there. It's just naming activity and misidentification. But yes, as Holler says, indeed, we experience countless dichotomies. Ego-self, you know, self being the true being, true nature, and ego being the false sense of self associated with body-mind, identified with body-mind. Anima-animus, you know, inner, outer gender, actually. You know, the gender of the consciously identified gender, and then the opposite polarity gender of deep mind. Body-mind dichotomy, we experience body and mind as apparently different. Subjective-objective, you know, meaning my thoughts versus what we all agree upon in terms of objective elements of the environment, and so on. These divisions require mending or healing. It's not that they're... It's the problem is not that these are real divisions. The problem is that the mind hasn't... doesn't know the unification that these poles exist as a unified field or a single field. You know, if you focus on the waves, you'll see countless waves. If you get to a higher altitude, you're seeing an ocean. The one ocean with countless waves. And so there needs to be expansion of consciousness or expansion of perception. That leads to that. That's associated with gnosis, of course. And then all of that returns to wholeness. This is so. It's very, you know, Jungian psychology and Gnostic symbolism is a very good fit, no doubt. And Jung was, you know, a Swiss Gnostic. Dear Carl Jung was very much a depth psychologist Gnostic, or Gnostic psychologist. And so the path is to return to wholeness. And, the role of Yeshua, or the healer, is to facilitate the self-healing or return to wholeness of the one who seeks the one. It's only the one seeking the one anyway. So, likewise, you know, so that return to unity or freedom from misidentification with body and mind, which leads to, you know, the experience of countless dualities or dichotomies, that whole thing is resolved. That could be called re-entering the Pleroma. So you see, the Pleroma has always been here. The unified field has always been here. Unity has never been broken. It's simply avidya, a restlessness, and an ahamkara, or self-conceit, being operative, that leads us to experience ourselves outside Pleroma, or the plenum. And so it's a healing of false belief. But the transformation must be of the seven energy centers. So it's not simply an intellectual shift. It's a transformation of body, mind, spirit, seven rays, seven energy fields, dynamics. It's the transformation of the vehicle itself, the energy transformation of the seven fields, of the seven rays of body, mind, spirit complex, or the total seven-dimensional self. That transformation is necessary to, quote, re-enter the Pleroma, or make, quote, reunification. It's really the destruction of the avidya, restlessness, and self-conceit, or fashioned sense of self. All that falsehood or fashioning needs to fall away. When it does, then one realizes, oh, this is the Pleroma, I am that I am, not better than anybody, because all is one, or, as Nityananda said, everyone is God. Anyway, the process of reunification is really a process of splitting through avidya, or dissolving avidya, or being free of ignorance, or, you know, putting down at last the three poisons, grasping, aversion, and ignorance. And their methodology, which is very Christian and very Western and very tantric, so maybe it's not that Western, is bridal chamber. But it's not, you know, man and woman having sex. there may be sexual ritual involved in Gnostic practice. In fact, there was in some groups. But it's really the union of love and wisdom. It's the unification, reunification of body, mind, spirit. It's the ending of belief in dichotomies, the freedom from dichotomous consciousness. And that's associated with the myth of Sophia, and they wrote documents, and so Sophia as wisdom. But you see, wisdom was understood as love wisdom. And yet, you know, then they talked about a symbolic union of Sophia and Yeshua, healing of the disruption, restoration of wholeness, which is change in mind. It's freedom from dualistic consciousness, okay? It's freedom from fashioning, naming activity, in the Buddhist perspective, freedom from the three poisons, and freedom from misidentification, we can say, with body-mind. But that freedom is a profoundly metaphysical, alchemical transformation of the seven rays and the seven energy fields, seven chakras. The transformation of mind, body, spirit is metaphysical, metaphysics, the physics of transformation of seven energy bodies. So it is not the same as thinking right or doing a physical behavior. So, yeah, I mean, people have to really, it's very few people, I believe, and it took me a while, very few people recognize that there's only one path. Even though there's two paths of polarity, there's only one work of soul evolution, and that is total transformation of body, mind, spirit, or total transformation of the seven chakra, seven-dimensional self. I mean, obviously we have a human body. Obviously we have a mind or consciousness that's distinct from it. Obviously there is something, there is a greater aspect of the human being that perceives having consciousness. We perceive or talk that there's a selfhood, a sense of self, but there's also this mind and consciousness. So that means that the one who perceives mind is greater than mind. That's called spirit. And so there's this triadic sense of self, body, mind, spirit. Body is the form, mind is the consciousness and the thought formulation, but the awareness that there is a mind is spirit, is of that which is greater than thought. The one that observes thought, talking about thought, is greater than thought, that's called spirit. That self, body, mind, spirit, really, you know, I mean, in my, you know, people argue about things, but to me, it's patent and obvious that just as the seven colors of the rainbow appear in the sky, likewise, there are seven chakras, major chakras, in the human being, period. And that can be divided to body, mind, spirit. And total transformation of the seven back to the one, from the seven through the three to the one, that is the work of soul evolution of all beings that are moving through plant and animal and up through all densities in the octave. And that one work, called magnum opus, the great work, is presented with countless terminology, you know, in countless ways, by multiple religions and spiritual traditions and sects and cults and New Age sources and pagan and indigenous groups globally for all of history in countless terms, in numerous ways. Mythological, poetic, psychological, theological, metaphysical, you know, whatever, doesn't matter, fine. But there's only one work, and that's the transformation of the sevenfold self, or mind-body-spirit complex, or mind-body-spirit, or self, that can be understood as a three and a seven, transforming back to the one. And so Hinduism has so much to say, Buddhism has much to say, Gnosticism has much to say, Ra has much to say, many teachers have had much to say, Western alchemy, psychology, depth psychology has much to say, transpersonal psychology, of all these different orientations are talking about the same work, That's the single point. We're all talking about the same work. And the people who can't understand that can't make use of the multiple traditions for their own self-development. But only the free thinkers, or people who don't bind themselves to a single tradition exclusively, those that are willing to take truth wherever they find it, from any tradition, any teacher, any source, historically, globally, religious, spiritual, metaphysical, New Age, alchemical, psychological, based in literature, wherever truth can be found, the free thinker may find it to do the one work that is discussed, or the topic, the one, you know, there's only one matter here. The one matter is the great work. The one matter, the Chinese Buddhists use that phrase, this one matter, which is soul evolution is the only game in town, and that's the nature of, that's the one work of all beings in the octave. We're all on the same path. Next time, we'll explore more of the bridal chamber sacrament, and see its Jungian correlate or Jungian correspondences in terms of depth psychology, archetypal psychology, and Holder's perspective, as well as metaphysics of seven dimensions and seven energy bodies transformation, as well as its correlation to Buddhism, Hinduism, and the ending of avidya, ignorance, and the return to the Logos, or the One Infinite Creator. Gnosticism is very fine, and Jung is a friend. Next time we'll start, if we can remember, anybody take note here, the sacrament of the bridal chamber, more than any other feature of the Valentinian Gnosis, gives us a clear indication of the psychological versus the theological character of Gnostic teaching and practice. So we're talking about psychological and theological, physical ritual and metaphysical effect. The particular sacrament called bridal chamber as a feature of Valentinian Gnosticism, how it's related to Tantrism, how it's related to union of male-female, anima-animus, Jungian, but how it's really associated with freedom from dualistic consciousness, which is associated with, obviously, naming activity. So you see, you know, you can see connections to Hinduism here. They very much talk about Shiva-Shakti union. Right? Male, female. Base chakra, root chakra. Root chakra, crown chakra. Right? Shiva-Shakti union and Sophia-Yeshua union, bridal chamber, is no different. Absolutely the same. The metaphysics, the kundalini, the energetics of Sophia-Yeshua bridal chamber union, obviously, is the same as a full circuit of energy from root to crown. Shiva-Shakti union. Kundalini uncoiling. Same, of course. That's what we're only talking about, a seven, you know, seven-dimensional, seven-ray beingness as the vehicle of the Logos transforming on the apparent path of soul evolution. We can talk of it poetically or psychologically, metaphysically, theologically, but it's really one work. So, next time we start with the sacrament of the bridal chamber. More discussion, and I think we will complete this page next time. We might want to look at the writings of the Valentinian school, but I really think we, not next week, but the week after, we probably really can get into the Gospel of Truth. And, you know, there's so much more. There's the Gospel of Philip, and then finally we're going to try to get our way to the Gospel of Thomas, which is also important. So anyway, thank you for being here. I hope you enjoyed. For free-thinking Gnostics of the modern day, welcome. The unified community of Buddhist and Hindu and Gnostic and sixth-density sages, welcome. Welcome you. Take good care. See you next time. Good night.